Though the tears may fall, my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. Though the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you.
Well, good morning, everyone. And why don't we start by taking a moment to pray for all of those amazing young people. And of course, there's many young people not on that video that we also have as part of our family, or maybe they're part of your different families or groups of friends. So let's take a moment to pray for them. Father, we recognise the pressures of school, and we thank you for each young person that you've given us into our family. Father, we pray for them, we champion them. God, we ask that you would bless them in their friendships and bless them in their work. Father, would you be close to them? Would you remind them that you are with them and that they can be your people in schools? Father, we dedicate them to you. We pray your blessing on them now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, welcome to week two of our 21 days of prayer and fasting. And we are looking at connecting with one another this week. And last week we looked at connecting with God, and Ian and Emma had a conversation. And then during the week, I hope you've taken the opportunity to connect in with God through the devotionals, like I mentioned, in the worship evenings. And so connecting with one another today and focusing in on that and think, what does that mean? Why is it important? What does that even look like right now in this strange season that we're continuing to be in? And we want to just think back to Isaiah 54, which we had as a word at the beginning of the year, and which Matt and the family really showed us this morning with the tents and driving those tent pegs deep. It said about enlarging the place of our tent and driving our tent pegs deep. And that's about creating kind of strong connections, strong friendships, strong relationships, so that when the storms of life come, we don't blow over like the tent the first time, thank you, Elliot, but we stay fixed in place like the second time, with the tent pegs having gone deep. And there's an African proverb that says, if you want to go fast, go alone, but if you want to go far, go together. Now, Stuart, as you and I have kind of kick off this conversation this morning, why is it so important that we're connected? Why do you think that proverb kind of rings true for us? What is it about connection that is so key?
Well, I think the first thing to say is this is who we're made to be. We're made in the image of God. God Himself, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, is very relational, full of love. for the different parts of the Trinity, and we're made in that image. And so we're made to be connected to God, but also to other people. We go right back to the start where in Genesis 1, where it talks about all the things that God creates, all the things that are good. And the first thing that's not good is when man is alone. And God said, it's not good for man to be alone. And so, you know, right at the start of the Bible story, we see God saying that. This is not good for people to be cut off and isolated. And you know, we've experienced some of that. Yeah. But it's good for us to be connected to one another.
Yeah, we've definitely been in a not good situation, haven't we? That just the sense of aloneness and loneliness and isolation that kind of 2020 has brought for so many people. And having that connection cut off in so many ways, it's been not good for so many of us, and that has a kind of an impact on our inner being. And it's really interesting. I love psychology and looking into all of that, and I remember right at the beginning of this pandemic, Henry Cloud, who's the American Christian author, clinical psychologist, he did some teaching around the psychology of crisis. And one of the things he spoke into was about connection. And I re-listened to it recently, and it just rung so true. That he says that connectedness is, it kind of helps us function. It's what drives us. It's kind of key to our functionality as humans. And obviously that's because God designed it that way. Like we're made to be connected to one another and to have deep relationship. And you think of a kind of a sports team when they're winning. And I know we support different football teams, so I'm not going to mention. But when a sports team is winning, and it's not often my team, but they, you know, they. It's because they're connected and they're moving as one, and they're, and so there's something about the drive and the function when you're connected together and you're rooted. And what 2020 has done, what this pandemic has done, is kind of ripped that away from us. And we've found ourselves, we're not seeing the people we usually see. We're not bumping into them in the hallways at school or college. We're not seeing them at work, in the office. We're not seeing them on Sunday in a church gathering situation. So kind of the very thing that connects us and the very thing that drives us and helps us function as humans has been taken away, and it is not good. It is not good.
Well, I particularly think that in terms of church, you know, we're whatever you think church is, something in our minds will go back to the Sunday expression of gathered together, and that's obviously what we don't have right now. And so people are mourning that, people are missing that, and you know, I'm missing that. I want to be with people. But at the same time, you know, I loved what Ian said yesterday. He talked last week even. He talked about the example of the chessboard and how if you want to train someone to be a master chess player, you take the queen out and you learn how the different pieces function. And then once you've learned how to do the other bits really well, you put the queen back in. And that sense of Sunday morning had become our queen. It had become the thing we were trying to do, all of our discipleship, all of our mission, all of our connecting with one another in 1 hour on a Sunday. That's a crazy model. And so it's highlighted for us, actually, where can we do the other bits? Where can we gather and do mission and do some of these other things in other places and within the restrictions?
Yeah, definitely. So with our queen having been taken away, carrying on with that analogy, with our kind of Sunday gathering having gone for the last 6 months, and online has been great, and it's been lovely to connect virtually where we can and for those who can and for who it works. But how have you responded? How have you found kind of, how have you managed to create some sense of opportunity for connection over this season, over these 6 months?
Well, I think it's been different at different times. I think small groups has been a key one. We had lots of people connected in small groups before. Maybe lots of them were meeting fortnightly. They've pretty much all gone weekly as people have wanted to connect more. We've set up other new things for people to opt into. Some of them have gone really well, some haven't. We've done the online hospitality, we've done quizzes, all kinds of different things. My kids have been involved in Zoom groups. That was really good before the summer holidays, and they're about to restart over the next couple of weeks. So that's another good opportunity for kids to get involved in connecting online. And then the other thing, I know small groups doesn't work for everyone or hasn't, you know, phone calls or maybe one-to-one walks or visits have been key for us. How have you done it?
Again, I think you're right, because it's been so long and there have been so many changes in regulations and guidelines. And at the beginning, when we were in proper lockdown, it was the phone calls and the online stuff. So I'll admit I'm I'm not the best person at this. It doesn't come naturally to me. And so this season's been really challenging for me in making myself kind of connect with others. But I've also got some incredible people as part of kind of the location in Enfield, Winchmore Hill, who just have a real sense of we're one family, we're one body, we're one church, and saying, I'm going to phone some people. And I've loved seeing that there's been connections in phone calls, and people, some people work differently. Some people have got a list and they're working through the list. It's like, I phoned that person on that day and I spoke to them about this, and that means I'll phone them on that day next yeah. week. They've been, you know, phenomenal. My mum's one of those. She's got her list going of who she's spoken to and making sure no one's missed in that sense. And then other people just led by the Spirit. Lord, who needs connecting today? And I've just loved the variety of that there's no hard and fast rule about who we connect with. And for those who we maybe forgotten on our list, God prompts someone else to phone. And that's been really lovely to have kind of lots of people phoning one another. So that's been great. We've had, yeah, the Zoom thing. Didn't we all get a bit zoomed out though? Zoom. Zoom, we had the hospitality, like you said, an opportunity to connect in. And we as a location were doing kind of every now and then a tea at 4:33, which people were invited to connect into. And yeah, there's been lots of kind of online stuff. Some small groups have gone online, like you said. And then as the restrictions lifted a bit, we started to do some visits. So Claire, who's part of our leadership team, she's hosting this morning online. She and I would visit some people, and it's just been a real joy. And we're going to visit people in their doorsteps, their driveways, their gardens, and we take our chairs. And we take our takeaway communion and our coffee cups and our water, and we'd settle in and just have time together. And often it was the people who live alone or don't have family who are at church with them, or you know, or are not so tech savvy, and so not able to connect in the ways that we were offering.
Sure.
And so we spent time there. And what I've loved about kind of being creative, having the queen taken away, as it were, again, using that, but and not having the Sunday, is actually, I find I've had longer and more meaningful conversations with people than I would on a Sunday anyway.
Yeah.
I think, you know what Sunday's like, it's a quick chat before the service and then focused on the service and a quick chat after. But actually I feel more connected to church family, maybe than before to some people, because we've been able to go deeper and yeah. drive those tent pegs a little bit deeper because we've had the time, which has been really special actually. To have that. So lots of different ways. We had a picnic a few weeks ago as well, where we said to people, we'll be in this park at a socially distanced, bring your own blanket and chair, and if you want to rock up. So yeah, lots of different ways. But it's tough. It's tough to stay connected when you're not seeing people face to face.
Yeah, and how's God kind of challenged you in your own connectedness during this season? What's been some of the things that have... been happening there?
There's been a couple of things, I think. One thing I realised quite quickly was it felt very similar to when I moved overseas some years ago. And what happened, and for anyone who's ever moved a distance or gone into a kind of a different season of life, is quite interesting because you lose friends because you can't stay connected with everybody when there's distance. And I found that happened again during this year, that where I might, in normal times, whatever those were, be able to pop and see this person, that I actually didn't have the capacity for that, first of all, couldn't physically do it either. So it's almost like my friendships shrunk down to just a few and kind of went deeper with just a few people and made sure I stayed connected to just a few. rather than trying to stay superficially connected to lots of people. So that was a really interesting thing. And it's actually been really lovely, again, to not just have surface conversation and rush meeting up with people, but to say, oh, let's have an hour on Zoom or have a call. So that's one thing I noticed. The other thing I noticed, which is, I don't know how this is going to make me sound, but I love my house. I live alone, which is a joy. And it's my house is often my sanctuary, if I'm honest. I close the front door, take a deep breath, go and put my tracksuit on, or pyjamas. They have been known to go on quite early in the evening. It's just my place of refuge. And yeah. I don't necessarily want people to come through the door because I've spent my day with people, or I just want that time. And I'm an extrovert, so that's saying something. But what I've found is, having spent days, weeks, months in my same four walls, that my house is no longer my sanctuary. Yeah. I don't treasure it in the same way. I'm still thankful for it. But I found I want to invite people in, and God's really done something special there. And I'm not sure I would have got there without the pandemic. I'm not sure I would have got there without lockdown.
Yeah.
Because I would have carried on rushing, and wanting to retreat rather than opening up my home. And so as guidelines have changed, I've really enjoyed having people in the garden when I can. And it's just been, or sitting on the driveway. I've got a little sun trap in my driveway, I've noticed, if I move the car. And Hayley and I have been known to have meetings on the driveway at a distance throughout lockdown. And yeah, it's really shifted something for me. And I feel like I've let go of my home being my castle, which I think is something our culture has. That we shut the front door and we shut people out. Mm. Some people are very gifted in hospitality, but I feel like I've grown in that weirdly. During lockdown, I've grown in my gift of hospitality. So yeah, so that's been two things I've really noticed for me. What about you? Because life looks a bit different for you.
Yeah,
so how's connecting looked for you?
My household's a bit fuller. There's five of us, three under nine. And it's been a challenge, I think, for any parent or family who've had to juggle pretty much not being able to go out much. You know, at one point it was an hour's exercise, yeah, was all we were allowed to leave for. But then everything's happening in one space, all of your homeschooling, all of your meals, all of your social time, you know, and that's a lot. And yeah, so at times it was survival, you know. It was almost different chunks. Like, if we can do this 6 weeks, and then something would happen, and then there's another 6 weeks. So it was kind of surviving. What do we need to do to survive? And I find the Henry Cloud stuff interesting about, you know, as our connectedness drops, our capacity drops, because sometimes I'd feel like just keeping our family going was all that you could manage. Yeah. And then you feel guilty. You think, well, no, but I'm also supposed to be, you know, leading church, connecting with people, helping everyone else who's finding it really tough, when actually, you know, you're trying to survive yourself. And so I think it's been a really strange season for a lot of people. And I think a lot of families have felt a lot of pressure. Mm. And you know, at those times, your faith and your ability to pray and to connect with God is then really, really important.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I think that's probably a good summary of it, really.
Yeah. I found as well that one of the keys has been to, again, something I've heard recently, but connecting kind of with a kindness in mind and being really kind to one another. You know, my reality this season has looked really different from your reality, and I can't imagine having a household of, you know, five people and trying to homeschool, and so kind of connect with you, having that in mind, that we're all going through different things, and not to underestimate, I think, the impact of this season and this year and the cutting of connection and how that is not good. And so when we connect with one another to be kind, and something else that I've noticed happen is, because we're not seeing people, we're not looking people in the eyes, even on a Zoom, you know, we're actually looking at ourselves a lot of the time. I think I'm not the only one. Sure. I'm not the only one. Please tell me I'm not the only one.
No,
but yeah, you look at yourself and you're not looking into people's eyes. And so there's a disconnect there as well. Even when you're with people, you're not with them and connecting in the same way.
Yeah.
And it's easy to almost depersonalize, and you know, the written word is so open to interpretation, you know, in emails and texts and WhatsApps and social media posts. And I think there's been a lot of disconnect and a lot of missing one another over this time. And yeah, to connect, I've even had that this week. There's been moments of misinterpretation from things I've written, and I thought, oh, I didn't mean that. And understanding that the person who's connecting back with me didn't mean that either. And actually, we're both going through stuff. You know, this is a tough, tough season, and we're not as resilient as we were. And we're not connecting with one another in the same way. And so to be kind to one another as we connect and as we reach out, I think I just feel like it's a word from God this morning, for us to really think, am I connecting with kindness? Is that my first thing? Is it kind? Is it true? Is it noble? Is the Philippian stuff? What am I saying? And in a season that is already dislocated, how do we bring unity with it? How do we walk in the opposite spirit of what's happening in culture?
Yeah.
And that's been, really important. And kind of connecting with kindness, even to your leaders. we are human. And I think that's really important. And I just think about how do we connect practically during the season when, rules are changing all the time. We've got our rule of six coming in tomorrow. So any plans we had to gather households is now on the back burner, and we're back to rule of six. And how do we make sure everyone is connected? How do we connect in with those we feel God's asking us to? Yeah. Who do we look to? And my first answer is always, surely we've got to look to Jesus. So as our example, how did Jesus connect? What can he teach us about a really good way to drive the tent pegs deep, to connect with one another?
Yeah, well, I love that guy. I think he's got a lot to say on life in general. And one of the interesting things in terms of a leader, but just as an example as well, he didn't try and lead everyone.
And I
find that really challenging because I want to lead everyone. Rather, he just chose 12 and he said, I'm going to lead these guys and I'm going to invest my life in them deeply for 3 years. He took them with him everywhere he went and he led them and he showed them and he modeled for them how to do mission, how to do discipleship, how to do life together. And then even more so, he had three who he journeyed with even more. Some of the places he went, he didn't take the 12, he just took three. Yeah. And so he really deeply invested in a much smaller number. And that if Jesus was here today in the COVID times, he wouldn't be gathering 12 because he would be within the restrictions, but he would probably do something with his three.
Yeah.
He'd go for a walk with them. He'd talk about the kingdom of God with them. He would, be praying and led by God.
Yeah.
And so I guess, to follow his example, how do we do that? And as a church, we can talk big. We can talk, let's do multiplication. Let's see lots of sites. Let's think really big picture. Let's have God impacting this whole region, which of course we want.
Yeah.
But if you look at Jesus' model, the way to do that is to actually make it smaller.
Yeah.
To invest in less people, less relationships, but do it deeper. Do it at a deeper level and a more of a heart connection.
Yeah.
And so I guess that's what we've got to work out. What does that look like for me? Who are the people that are my people? Are they the small group I'm meeting with? Or if I'm not in a small group, who are those people that actually I'm going to prioritize time with because they cheer me on and they challenge me?
Yeah.
And I think those are two things to ask. Who are the people that do that for you?
Yeah, I love that. Who cheers you on and who challenges you? You say small groups, and I've heard the phrase, we don't want to be a church with small groups. We want to be a church of small groups. And I think this season, we almost have no choice but to be little groupings. And I find the phrasing, the language small groups, I kind of have a little reaction to that from my history with small groups or Bible studies or cell groups or whatever you want to call them. And I react because it feels like another thing I have to do. I've got to make time to meet with that group of people. But actually, when you reframe it, and it's about those people who cheer you on and who challenge you, who you want to drive the tent pegs deep with and have strong connection with.
Yeah.
They're basically my friends, is what we're saying, isn't it?
You hope so.
I hope so. But it's not another group. It's, like you say, who are my people? Who am I connecting with? Who are my friends? Who are my deep relations? Who are my three? Who are my 12? And it just shifts the mindset. So if anyone's like me and doesn't love the idea of small groups, I just want to say, kind of forget the label.
Yeah.
It's okay. It's just friends. And I've got time for friends that I can do.
Yeah.
And that's been really lovely over this season as well. Kind of a group of four of us who meet together to pray and cheer each other on and challenge one another. And, there've been walks happening between just two or three or four. And it's been really, really great to have the time to invest in those friendships as well and cheer each other on and challenge one another. And I think if we go back to kind of the Henry Cloud stuff, but also back to Genesis 1, which is where we started, when God made us to be in relationship with one another. He made us to be connected.
Yeah.
And it's not good to be alone. And then from that, it's how we function. It's what drives us, that the connectedness. And I'm so thankful when I think about my small group, and I will use the word small group.
Yeah.
I think about my small group, actually, when I've had a quick exchange with them, whether it's over WhatsApp, whether it's a walk with one of them, whether it's a late night phone call, which there was this week when I was in tears about something. And you know, I come out of that feeling cheered and challenged.
Yeah.
And there's something really special about that. And I feel able to function again. And I've not really made the connection, maybe until this moment as I'm saying it, that actually when I spend time connecting deeply, I am able to function better. And that's just a God-given design. And as we're living in that. So I want to ask you, Stuart, before we go, and I'm dreading this, but before we go to open questions from the chat, which Hayley will bring in a moment, she's going to bring us some questions. I just want to ask you, how this week can people kind of make the first step to connecting in with one another?
Well, I think, the first step is actually being real about where you are. Because I think if you're not able to be real, even just with God as a starter, then I think you're not going to come into a relationship with someone else in the same way. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's what I found really helpful this week. The worship evenings, all of the Facebook lives are actually still on Facebook, and there's the worship from Saturday night and Monday night on YouTube. Engage with some of those. Make some time to just center yourself on God and work out, where am I at in this? What's the things that are important to me, hard for me? And then once you've done that, who are your people? Who are the people you're going to intentionally approach in terms of relationship and discipleship? And who's going to cheer you on, and who's going to challenge you? And that's what we want to encourage. For some people, that'll be a hard thing. Maybe you don't know where to start with that. And we're here for you. So please send us a message. You can click on the live prayer right now. There's people ready and waiting to pray with you. But also we can contact you this week and start having conversations about who do you want to connect with? How do you want to be more connected? And we're passionate about making that work.
Great.
So bring on the questions.
She's smiling. It's all okay. Oh, I see your questions. This is the fun of it. Here we go, Stuart.
Go on then.
If I'm new to Restore, how can I meet people and make new relationships?
Great. Yeah, I mean, it's a good question. I think there's lots of different ways you can. There's groups that are already operating. Sometimes they can be quite hard ones to kind of join in a group that's been established for a long period of time. Yeah. We're going to start two new groups, hopefully, in the autumn term, which are online small groups, so you can access that from wherever you are. I'd encourage whoever's asked the question, find out about that. We're going to give you information about it and have a go at that. Also, there's people on team who are very happy to meet up with you, go for coffee, have a walk, kind of whatever works. But it would be great to kind of meet some people face to face, particularly if they're new, tuning in to Restore. You know, what a strange time to join and feel like you've joined and feel like you know you're part of it, but you don't know who anyone else is. We're also going to be bringing back the online hospitality zone at the end of church in the next couple of weeks. And we've worked out how to do breakout rooms.
Great.
So rather than basing that around a quiz, we're actually going to base it around kind of smaller groups. You can get to know people, have some smaller conversations. And so that's going to be rolled out soon as well.
That's great.
A question for you. If I'm feeling isolated and struggling, how do I break out of that?
Yeah, that is tough. That's a really hard thing. It takes courage and a little bit of determination to just take that first step. So I know from my own experience, if I am feeling isolated, I almost have to force myself to connect with someone else. I find those times when I wait for others to connect with me, I start playing the isolated victim story in my head.
Yeah.
And so it's like actually this week when I said I was I made a late night phone call in tears, I was feeling quite alone. I was feeling quite upset about something. And I had a moment, I was like, I could brew on this and spin out about this, or I could phone someone.
Yeah.
And so I messaged them because it was later. I said, is it okay to make a call? And I phoned someone from my small group, one of my people who cheers me and challenges me. And I phoned her and I said, I just needed to speak to you because I'm feeling this way.
Yeah.
And I had to be courageous and really honest that I wasn't doing well.
Yeah.
And I think that's the hard thing. And so if someone is feeling isolated or discouraged, I want to really encourage them to take that first step to make contact. And if you don't have a person, then make it us.
Yeah.
Contact us.
Yeah.
We want to be there for people, and we want to bring people into community and into relationship. So we're here for people.
Great. Good answer. Yeah, and it's hard to make that first contact. If you're finding it hard,
yeah.
sometimes what you want to do is hide.
Yeah.
And so I like the idea of sending a message to someone.
Yeah.
I'm not okay.
Yeah.
You know, like,
yeah.
Bone me. Like,
yeah. And we've done that to one another before.
Yeah.
Stuart,
yeah.
I'm not okay.
Help.
Yeah. So here's a nice one. Do you have a favourite way to connect with others, like a walk or food? And then this is definitely for you, or a Marvel movie.
Do you know what? Marvel movies are good, but on Wednesday we had our first football small group.
Yes.
In about 6 months, and it was beautiful. I just loved being with the guys. I love connecting with people through sport because the people you're on the team with, a bit of what you were talking about earlier, you connect in a different way. And then the other people who you're against, you still like them. But, you know, it's a different level of connection to just talking, or eating's good. Eating's always good.
Great.
But, yeah, a football match is probably my number one I would go to. A final question. What's it like to be a woman in leadership within Restore?
Ah, and that's all we've got time for. It's great. I'm going to speak directly to you. No, I'll speak to you. Honestly.
Yeah.
I don't know any different. Like, I've been really fortunate in all of my leadership, in all of my, from my teens through to now, and that's, you know, spanning some decades now. But I've been really fortunate to be in places where women are championed, and that we're not there as tokens, and we're not there for any other reason except we're the person for the role, the person for the job. And so to be a woman in leadership is just to be in leadership, honestly.
Yes.
I don't know any different. I don't know how else to answer. It's certainly not an issue.
Well, that's part of the culture that we established. Actually, we believe in men in leadership.
Yeah.
And we believe in women in leadership.
And young people in leadership.
Young people. And there's an anointing that God puts on people. And actually, that's more important than gender or, you know, some of these other things. And so, you know, we will challenge and cheer for people in leadership.
Yeah.
You know, and
absolutely.
Yeah, young leaders as well.
Great
absolutely.
Question. Well, we are going to ask questions again next week, and there'll be opportunity. We're dreaming up some ideas to open up questions on a wider scale. We're going to invite the worship team back. And Stuart, would you pray for us just before we go back into worship?
Father God, we thank you for the time of sharing and just, opening our hearts, really. And I pray that people will just realise that your plan for us, your design for us, is to be connected with one another. And Father, would you just make it really obvious to people what their next step is? Maybe it's one person to reach out to this week. Father, would you help us in that? Would you help us to be brave and courageous if we're feeling cut off? Would you help us to reach out? And Father, would you bring us together as a church family in this time where we can't be an expression like we normally would on a Sunday? Would you help us to learn the lessons of this season that we might do all of the rest of the bits better? We might connect better, we might do mission better, we might do discipleship better, that we can come together on a Sunday again when we finally can, and it'll be a celebration of all that you've done amongst our community. Would you bless us now? I pray your Holy Spirit on each person who's watching right now at home. You would give them boldness and courage for the week ahead. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.